you were buying this here today, in fact, your gift, your art was here about monoliths. It was, thank you for offering that to the monks. You might stop by and look at the monks' monolith at the home center on Howard Street, Old Oak Park. It's taking about 10 days to create. We'll sweep it up this coming Saturday. I can't remember what time, but probably Saturday afternoon. And then we put it away. Or it's a little, we put it in the water source to bless the environment. And we believe that just even a pinch of sand applied to the crown of a dying person, maybe with a little butter or oil to make it stick there, guarantees a human form in its life, so it has definiteness power. These bones are from down in Shartse Monastery, specifically down in Shartse Pukang, which is one dormitory out of 11. And their present building is falling down. They need a new structure for 500 bones. In general course of study, to become a Geshe, we have in the center, here we have Coach Rinpoche. He's a recognized here in Alama, Geshe Kamiyeshe, Geshe Puzo. And then we have Songdu, Jingyao, and Zhongyao. So we received Geshe's degrees about 25 years of study, 5 a.m. to midnight, 6 days a week, 5 major texts and 6 perfections, reason, logic, factors in the mind, emptiness, about how nothing has any essence. We believe that things lack essence, that fabrications of parts, both outer and inner phenomena, are selfless. They study cosmology. They also study their precepts. Fully ordained that monks have 253 vows or precepts that they take. They keep their precepts, no harm is done to the environment or to living beings. A monk is a very small footprint on the planet. We have 2 sets of ropes, a bowl, a teacup, and a spoon, and their chest. Maybe a watch, glasses, but that's about it. Often 2 or 3 monks, maybe 4, will share a room. We live in South India, it's a refugee camp, 2 meals a day, associate bread. So still, we see new arrivals every week from Tibet, young men that want to teach this education so they can trek over the Himalayas, the highest passes, so they are not caught when they enter the South India, so we'll disperse. So in the beginning, we're going to, the monks will recite some of the prayers to the medicine Buddha to start this event, and then Geshe Puzo will begin a short lecture, later followed by question and answer. So thank you again for inviting us, sir.
secondly, they have to receive the transmission. We have the oral transmission, and then the empowerment on those medicine Buddha. Then, so they have to recite every morning to set up the motivation. Because if you have the positive motivation, then even by thinking positive on your patient or somebody you want to help, it will be more stronger. But if you don't have the motivation within inside, that's like you're forced to do something, or like you are not willing to do something, then even that you may be giving the most expensive medicine or to that patient, then it never works as much as that if you don't have a motivation. But if you have a positive motivation, that is the most powerful thing. So this is the reason I think that some of the medicine, even if maybe a very simple medicine also, that you work to that patient because of your intention. Because your intention and motivation are such a powerful that create some potential even from that medicine also. Even by touching, even by the way nearly that person, showing a happy or smiling person, a smiling face, it makes a huge difference. So this is how like study medicine, they have to do that. And even being a monk or so, like we act like a nurse also. We call the Sangha. Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, we also have to act like a nurse because Buddha has given a teaching, and the Buddha is like a doctor, and the medicine that Buddha has prescribed the teaching. Teaching is like a medicine. And that medicine to break down into a certain part, like how many doses a day that you have to take, only the nurse will help them. So simple as even the Buddha give a whole bunch of teaching, but if you try to practice all together, it may not work. But same thing like a doctor giving a whole bunch of medicine, and if the patient take everything all at once, it may not help. So the nurse has to break down that maybe two times a day, what kind of food and diet and you have to eat and drink. Because of that, then it's perfectly work for the patient. So that's how, like even the monk or so, the moment when we wake up, we have to set up the motivation. And then after that, we bless our speech, bless our feet, bless our hand, so that whichever, like when we speak, may it become as a healing to others. Even when we touch somebody, may it become as a healing to others. Even when we step forward, any ground, in case that if we accidentally kill some beings on the floor, then may this being may have a higher rebirth. So that's why the moment that when we wake up, we have to bless those things. And the only reason is to set up your motivation. And then motivation also, it depends now. Because sometimes motivation can be very least scale, or the medium scale, or the high scale. So some of the motivation sometimes, like it may be a selfish motivation, okay, I want to do something that to get name and fame and something like that. Then it's a very small scale, because that, especially like being a Tibetan Buddhist practitioner, we never motivate just for selfish reason, because it's just a small amount of benefit. But if you set up, we call the altruistic motivation, we call the mind of enlightenment, then even you may be doing a small amount of good action or benefiting others, but the accumulations of merit that you achieve through will be countless. It's like in Buddhist, how you know, it helps. It's like even you do a small grain of generosity, or one grain of generosity, but your motivation is to benefit all these sentient beings and the environment, then the accumulation only for just for self reason, self benefit. If you did it, do a huge amount of good action also, but the accumulation is a matter of just one. And that can be exhausted very easily. And that's why maybe when you work, sometimes you physically get tired, mentally get tired, because our expectation is so small, only thinking about self, maybe for some benefit or something. So that's why you get easily tired. But if you really set up a motivation that, okay, I want to dedicate my, since this is my main job, I really want to help others. You set up your intention from the very day. Even if you may work hard also, you may get physically tired, but mentally you are very strong. This is what like, we also experience that. We travel throughout the United States, working almost every night. But I always feel that I am very fortunate to get tired of doing good things. So this actually is your job. You are doing your best job. So that's why like you may get tired, but you may enjoy something. Oh, I have the highest opportunity to do such a good job, and I get tired of doing things. But most of us, we get tired of doing nonsense. That's why this is the benefit that you can apply into your practice. And since like mandala, are you the one who created this mandala? See, mandala can maybe it will be very helpful also. In a sense, mandala is a celestial universe of one enlightened being. And though it shows a thing that mandala is way outside somewhere, but you know, the actual mandala is you yourself. You yourself will be the core of the mandala. The outside is your own body. The center of the mandala is your own brain consciousness. So when you create something to benefit others, you can consider yourself as a pure mandala, and the center of that mandala is your own main consciousness. So when you try to benefit others, normally if we are ordinary being and if we are not mindful, then we only use the subconsciousness, normally five subconsciousness, feeling, sight, smell, taste, and hearing, right? So that means if you really analyze carefully, we are only using this subconsciousness, but we never use our main consciousness. So setting up your proper motivation is to motivate, set up your main consciousness. Try to make that main consciousness as a potential. Because when you look through that main consciousness, that itself will be the center of your own mandala. And from that, this main consciousness is a multi-dimensional image. That means it can look through anywhere. That means when you close your eyes, when you sleep or dreaming, it can wander everywhere, right? This is kind of one of the few parts of main consciousness. So if you really set up your main motivation with that, motivating the main consciousness with the depth of your chakras or heart, then that is the main one that can create so much strength within yourself. But only if you are not using that main consciousness and only use only subconsciousness, eyes, then you get this eye tired, hearing also get tired, feeling also get tired, because we are only using those things. So especially like since you're working for others, try to use your main heart, main consciousness. And this consciousness also, if you look, it can be a small amount of main consciousness. But if you really think positively, if you think elaborate, then that very consciousness, it may be a very tiniest, like a molecule, because it's a very subtle consciousness. But once you train to motivate that in a positive way, all the same motivation, types of universe. That means we have a saying that maybe my consciousness is smaller than a mustard seed, but that mustard seed itself is the size of the universe. Because that's why the enlightened mind, ownership mind means you become one with the universe. But when since we don't use this one as a main consciousness, as a pure mandala or the core of that mandala, then it becomes very small, very tiny. It looks like our consciousness, because that's why we hardly use it. Our main consciousness, we hardly use it, right? So that's why early morning, when you try to meditate, try to go into the center of your heart. And even if you close your eyes, or even like half open, look through, sometimes we call it third eye also, right? So that's why you look at and look through that main consciousness. And when you look through that main consciousness, since this main consciousness is a neutral, it doesn't create positive or negative, but it has more potential to create more positive if you can use it. It has so much potential. That's why we call it every being has a nature of enlightened Buddha, we call it enlightened being. Everyone has this nature. So that is the main one we have to try to use in when you try to serve others. That's why when you are in that mindfulness with this proper motivation, then that person will find some peace. Wherever you go, you will find some peace and happiness. There's no such thing that you can be easily distracted by any difficulties and challenges and obstacles that you're facing. It won't distract easily because you are in that, you're using your main consciousness as a true motivation to stand strong. But if we don't use this one, main consciousness, as a true core in your own focus to help others, then you can get easily tired because you are only using your main subconscious. Try to set up this motivation. When you set up this motivation, then you will be very, you will still enjoy, you will still enjoy it. And then one thing, when you work and try to study these things, rejoicing. Rejoicing is one of the greatest factors because we never rejoice. We never rejoice firstly about the good deeds of our own action. Because your main service is to help others, to benefit the patient who really need help. And if we don't rejoice, not rejoicing is like right after doing something, then we get angry or frustrated and then like feel negative, then it's a waste of our own good energy. We have a saying that you are making a footprint and then you're erasing by your own hand. You are doing such a great job and then you're erasing by your own hand means your own negative thinking. So why do you want to erase your own good action by your own illusions, your own anger, your own desire, your own hatred, your own jealousy, your own ego and pride? It's useless because you are doing such a great job and at the same time you are erasing. So that's why always try to rejoice on the good deeds of your own self. Because the more you rejoice, it's not only benefiting yourself, it will let you promote yourself to be a better and stronger person. And then also try to rejoice on the goodness of your own others also. This is another problem that we never do. That means if somebody is trying to help others, we instead of rejoicing them, we feel jealous. We feel jealous or sometimes by pitying each other. No need to pit. As long as if you have a sincere, good motivation inside, you don't have to feel jealous about it. You do it sincerely. But if you try to trick on each other, then it's not a good motivation. So that's why your motivation and rejoicing when you do something to help others, that is the key to being
peace and happiness. And wherever you go, we call it a person with a good motivation can fit in any society. Wherever, which colors, which class, any color doesn't matter. As long as that person has a good motivation, then this person can fit in anywhere. And then every once in a while, try to meditate, try to set up. Because we have a saying that even the youngest child, maybe around 10 years or younger, if they can meditate a day, 10 minutes a day, they will never face a depression in their life. The only reason why that we feel loss of depression is a lack of self-confidence and fear is because our way of thinking, our main consciousness is so narrow that it's smaller than that mustard seed. So we have so many issues in our life, so many expectations and loss of greed and jealousy and ego and pride. All this is so big, so it is easy to strike into you and make you feel pain and suffer. So each time when you meditate, set up your motivation is to expand that motivation like a spacious mind or open heart. So that even things happening in your life, it can be easily get passed through, maybe some distraction, but it can easily let go. But if you don't meditate like that, then if even the smallest thing happen in your life, it can strike you and you feel some kind of disturbance in your mind. So try to meditate, especially early morning, since like you're in this field. So if you can meditate, it's a wonderful practice. It can really make you a good day and then a good start. And then also when you, before you go to bed, sometimes try to meditate what you have done, try to rejoice. If you cannot rejoice during the daytime, when you go to sleep, just before you go to sleep, try to sit down and meditate and what you have done in the day. Try to feel the joy. Oh, somebody has done something, you rejoice with your heart. And then think positive, okay, I really did something good that I want to do more. So that this is how that one can help others. And now, I don't know about this can be used in your field or not. Normally, a lot of compassion is called. Though, like if you can practice about love and compassion, maybe this will be helpful to you all also. Because in our field, that we always have to use the love and compassion. The reason why that we have to practice on this two things on love and compassion is because we all have two wishes. Which is or forest or biggest animal or the tiniest being, we only have two wishes. Maybe we think that we have more than two wishes. And those two wishes, we don't want suffering and we want happiness. That is everyone, even the smallest being also, they want happiness. They don't want suffering. And to fulfill this too, it's only by practicing love and compassion. That's why we call it love means when you wish everyone to be happy, is love. Compassion means you wish everyone to overcome from the suffering. That is called compassion. And compassion and love shouldn't be just limited or biased that through our own relatives or families or our own the whom that we desire. If you have those love and compassion, then it's not the true love and compassion. It is out of our desire, out of our expectation or those things. So unconditional love, unconditional compassion without making differentiation. And in order to practice this one also, maybe you know some reason behind, maybe it will help. The reason behind is to think about the kindness of every human being. Like for example, we survive depending 100% depending on others. Without depending on others, we cannot survive. I think we all know that. Without depending, we are 100% depending on others. So if we are 100% depending on others, then there's no way that we can think about just for only for my own self. So how we are 100% depending on others is like the hall that we are gathered here. I didn't build the hall, you didn't build the hall. It's because of the kindness of somebody who built the hall, we are gathered here. And then light, food, clothes, the road of heart, everything you look at, I didn't make it. It's somebody because of the kindness of somebody who made this one and they're kind to me. And then, like, the element. Elements, I didn't make the element. It's because of the kindness of the element we are surviving here. So if you look at everything, then everything is kind to me. But sometimes we think that there are somebody who is trying to disturb me and trying to create a problem to me. We can think like an enemy. But if you think on this point of view, the kindness, everything is kind of me, if you look at that point of view, actually the enemies who try to harm me are the most kind to me too. Because they are giving me the opportunity to practice patience. See, so patience is the highest practice of all. So those enemies are giving me this opportunity. And then the bakers are kind to me, they are giving me opportunity to practice generosity. And then the gods and Buddhas are kind to me because they are giving me opportunity to overcome my own problem and help me to achieve realization. So who is harming me? And sometimes our greatest misconception, we call the misknowing also, it's me still, called me, I, as if that I have existed without depending on anything. So if you look at it carefully, then we also didn't came from nowhere. We do came from somewhere, right? So if you look at that, then it is because of the kindness of one's own parents, we are here. Doesn't mean that the moment we are conceived in mother's womb means we are just born like that. Doesn't mean the moment we are born out from the mother also doesn't mean we are grew up like that. So it's because the parents, love, care, protection, education, guidance, all because of this we are here. Without any scar, without any mask. If we have just left over the moment we are born, I don't think we will be in this situation. So that clearly shows that how the parents are kind to us. So how can I say, I want this, I don't want it? That makes me very tiny, very cheap person. So that's how you can think like that, that how I am alive because of all these things. How can I just think of myself? This is the reason that I must, now I know that every living being and environment are kind to me. Then how can I be just selfish and think only for myself? Then in order to, so now I must do something if everything is kind to me. Then, so in order to do something, to repay the kindness we call, we have to repay the kindness because of it. Everything is kind to me. So that's why the highest way to repay the kindness is by generating love and compassion. And your service will be the highest practice to repay the kindness to others. So that's how sometimes we can think like, oh, it's not like I have this education and I can do that and I can help them. Don't think like that. They are kind to me. They are giving me an opportunity to practice all these things. If you think like that, it will be really a true service then. Instead of like, okay, I can do this, me, I have this knowledge and I am doing this, then it's a negative thing to think. They are kind to me. It's helping me to practice this. To be nervous, or to help others, it's giving me this opportunity. That's the best way to motivate yourself. It will always try to set you the positive motivation. And sometimes we call like, in order to help, we always try to encourage to help your parents. Because sometimes we take it for granted. Take it for granted in a way that, for example, we have saying that if somebody, a strange person, whom that you never met before or never heard before, even never saw before, and all of a sudden giving a one cup of coffee, I think we all have every word to express, oh, I met this person who was so kind, he gave me a cup of coffee or tea, and thank you, and you're very kind, you're very lovely, you know, we may express that. But how many cup of coffee or tea that we receive from our parents? If that one strange person receives so much appreciation because of that one cup of coffee, I think that our parents deserve more than that. Sometimes we take it for granted as if that we have kept something over there and we are demanding from them. So that's why I try to appreciate like that. Because if the strange person deserves so much because of that one cup of coffee, I think our parents deserve more than that. So that's how I try to start like that. Then that brings a truth of common sense. We are the social animal. We need a good friend around. We cannot live isolated. So start first from our own parents. More the parents, I don't think they want anything from you. Parents always want your success. They want you to stand on your feet. They want you to be a good person. I don't think parents want you to be negative or violent, just make money and just like cold-hearted like a machine. They want you to be a good person in your life. They want you to serve others. That's how that they wish it. So try to be to serve and take care. And then the best way to help your parents is not to disturb them. Because we always try to disturb and create all these problems. It's good that once you help, then it's a, because you are already young. Time will come that the responsibility will come to you. We have a saying when we're young, when the mother is cooking, look delicious. When the father is working, look easy. But when we cook ourselves, it's not as delicious as mother used to cook. When we work ourselves, it's not as easy as like father used to work. So this one, that means it really appreciate how they work hard for us. One, father and mother working and feeding everyone, 10 or 12 children, they can feed. Right now, why not? But we are too much attached to this metal thing. We want so many things in our life, and sometimes we forget our own humanity. So this is what, like, sometimes, fulfill your wish also in a way, firstly towards parents and your life, and live in a contentment. Life is something that we call it, don't try to fulfill your desire, because desire is the one that burns away our own whole life. We are craving on something and then we go after this to achieve, and then sometimes we lose our own value, our own human value. Be happy with what you have. This will make you more peaceful, peace in your mind, more peaceful mind. Otherwise, if you are just chasing after your desire, then you will never find peace in yourself. Even you may achieve, become the most richest person also, you may be sleeping in a mansion also, you may still eating in a golden plate also, I don't think you will find peace. You will still crave for something more and more. So our whole life is just wasted on that. That's why, like, be happy with your work sincerely. That's very important. It can make you more happier. When you work sincerely, we have a saying, when you work sincerely with your good motivation, even just having a cup of water or tea is good enough to nourish your body. But if you don't work sincerely with all these negativities and expectations, even that glass may change with golden glass, you drink all this. Now instead of water, then it will change into vodka and all this. Still not happy. then you may drink all this smoke, all this cocaine or crack or whatever it is also, not happy. Because our desire makes you go towards that. And you will then find that peace. And then maybe for some reason that this will try to space out your feelings and try to make you happy. But peace is like a fire hidden under the ash. When you have those drugs and those drinking, it's like you're trying to, you think that it is like to feel better. But it is like a fire under the ash you are hiding. The fire is still under. That means the moment the drug is over or your what do you call it, hangover is over or something, then still there will be the fire inside. So why do you want to lose those things? So if you have a good intention, this will really broaden up your intention and motivation and make you feel stronger and better. And you work sincerely. That will really respect, and people will respect, anyone will respect. But person who goes to that direction and try to hide our own feeling, actually maybe respecting oneself, but nobody will respect. That we all know, right? So why do you want to do such things? Having this knowledge, you have this all the qualification and education, then it's just a huge invest. Firstly, the parents, the loan that you have, a whole huge amount of loan to study this one, is just wasted for nothing. So when you have these parents are really encouraging you, you are working hard to study, to achieve this goal, don't go into those directions. Because this will just waste your entire life. And then it's a becoming of, we have such a huge mentality. Every ability we have, we call we are the most intelligent and the smartest being in this universe. And if we act like worse than the animal or beast, then what rest we call? Then why do we call this mandala? Because our body is a more pure everything that we can do if we use to make proper use of. We can do better than that. So that's why make use of this when you have this opportunity. Okay, so that's it.
Yes. Any questions? Let's talk about blessing their uniforms, their instruments, the bed, the medicine. Could you talk about that for a minute? How to set up when you go into a person's room on a blessed site, their own uniform, the pills, whatever. Could you speak about that a bit?
Yeah, that's why, like, as I told you, we bless the speech, we bless the things, we bless the medicine also. Actually, in Tibetan, is every medicine, like before we give to a patient, that it has to be blessed by a nurse or doctor. And then the clothes we are wearing also, we have to bless all this. And obviously, the speech, we have to bless everything. The morning, that's why, like, when you go to the that a doctor, you will find that before they open the main office, they will do your prayers and at least 15 minutes of prayers together. And once they have studied the doctor or nurse, they have to go on a retreat, at least 2 weeks of retreat on the medicine Buddha. So that's why that they really want to make you of your body, speech, and mind in a most positive way. If you cannot, then as I'm saying, just try to do some short meditation a day. That will really help, especially even by setting up your motivation. If you have a positive motivation, it's really, really powerful. Any questions, please?
Blessing, are there specific words that you say or is it from your heart?
And then for us, we have a specific one to decide. But as from your side, getting the motivation. Motivation is the key, because motivation is such a powerful thing. It can like motivate, even if maybe a solid object also, if you have true faith in motivation, you can create nectar. This water won't be as a water, but it will be a nectar. But if you don't have a motivation, even if it's a very negative feeling, that this can be even worse than a water. That's why we don't, in order to quench our thirst, we drink water. But some of them, they don't. They drink, they want more than more other things. So that's why the motivation is very helpful to set up your intention. It's like if you want to go to New York, then you really set up the strongest inspirational motivation, then it will be easier. But if you don't have any will to go, and you don't have any motivation to go, then it will be very difficult to reach there.
Would you give us an example of how to bless the message? Like, if you're not Buddhist, what would you say? Like, the blessing
person is a mantra. That's a,
if you're not Buddhist.
That's what I'm saying, motivation.
Okay, but if you give us a small use, what would you prayer be like?
In Tibetan,
actually. No, I'm asking you to help in their world. May this medicine bless this being. What would you say? Something like that?
I don't know in English. Tibetan is normally it's a short prayers. Especially making prayers to Narasi Buddha, that even just a small, even listening, hearing the just a mere word of that medicine Buddha, may this become as a true benefit to help every living beings to overcome from their suffering. And through that, enlightened being, that I truly want to make prayers so that whichever, that whatever I do to help others may become as a true potential to relieve from their suffering. I think this is the brief the meaning of what we started. Medicine Buddha. Because those medicine Buddha is when they are meditating and practicing through the stages of the path to enlightenment, their whole intention or the entire intention is to help others. How can I be helpful to others? How can I benefit others? So their intention is so strong that even being myself as an ordinary person, how to motivate myself, then sometimes, like, I don't know how to motivate, for example, then I just make a question. How did you motivate? Like, they ask a question to Buddha, medicine Buddha himself, that how did you motivate yourself to help others? I also want to motivate the same way as you have did like that. So that way also you can think like that to motivate yourself. I also want to motivate the same way as you did when you are practicing and achieving realization. So I also want to motivate like same that you. So that's where also you can set up your motivation. Oh, mandala, yes. I think some of you have visited the home center in downtown. We are creating the mandala of medicine Buddha. I think it's appropriate for this healers and who are doctors and nurses. This is very it's appropriate for this. And the whole purpose of creating this mandala is to heal, help, and anyone who encounter, who visit and receive this blessing, is to help them to heal. And healing is not only about the sickness only. Actually, our main disease that we have is our desire, our hatred, our delusions, our ego and pride and jealousy, naive or stupidity, and then wrong view. These are the main disease that we have. We
because of the disease, then the sicknesses arise. So that's how like creating this mandala is to help us to heal from those kind of disease, and then the sickness gather. So that's why like we're creating the mandala of medicine Buddha in home center in downtown. Sometimes like when we meditate on this medicine Buddha or any mandala, actually the mandala here that they created, actually when we meditate, you have to look, use your total consciousness in the main consciousness. And when you look through your heart, not through here. So we look to see that this mandala is right in the center of your chakras, and your main consciousness is in the center of your heart. And from there, look through this. And this is a multi-dimensional eyes. It has, it can travel to any space. So when you look through this eyes, and then with the pure motivation, then everything becomes more pure and celestial. That becomes a mandala of your own heart chakra. That's how the healing session also, if you truly look through your heart and try to bend with others, that will be more powerful. That will be great for you also.
Distract easily, our speech can be distracted easily, and then
distract with those patients, then our speech would be very nasty. Then the face looks, maybe we may look nicer when we are in a normal person, but when we lose a patient, that means we look like monkey's butt. Because it really changes the entire complex when we lose a patient. And then obviously the speech and the negative thinking, way of thinking, won't be in a straight way, positive way. So it will distract every part of the body, speech and mind. So why do you want to rest by distracting all the things? So that's why the patient, just practicing this patient on that point, then you won't get easily distracted, you won't get any, the speech will be normal, your physical body will be normal, so you will do positively, properly, but you will be out of mind when you lose the patient. So that's why it's a really powerful practice, especially in your field. And then, concentration is a virtue. Enthusiastic perseverance, also need, because you have to work maybe sometimes overnight or over the job. So if you don't have that enthusiasm in working on your own field, then anything can distract you and make you lazy, make you feel angry, make you feel tired. But your enthusiasm on doing a virtuous action, on helping others, that will give you the inner strength also. And then, of course, the concentration is to be mindful that what you're working with, even giving a small water or medicines or anything or so, if you have a really pure thought with a pure concentration, then you won't mess up with the different kind of medicine. So you need a pure concentration on that also, and think positive. And of course, the wisdom. Wisdom is the last one, and this will help you to balance with whatever you're doing. Even if you want to do help in generosity for the first one, if you don't have wisdom, then you're giving a medicine also may not work properly. Maybe you will give extra medicine also, overdose medicine also, but the wisdom, your wisdom will perfectly balance that, okay, how many dose, how many milliliter or milligram of medicine that you have to give. This one, your wisdom will try to control you and help you to balance with what kind of help that you can do. But if you lack wisdom, then sometimes one of the things that lack of wisdom will make you stupid. You may have a good heart also, you always try to do something good, but if you lack wisdom, then it will become stupid. Or sometimes people will misuse you also, because you are too soft, because you are too kind, and people will try to misuse you. But if you use proper wisdom, then you won't look stupid. You will be very wise and can benefit wisely. And you cannot distract yourself also, because lack of wisdom will always distract yourself. And at the end, you will complain, why I have a good heart? Why people try to mistreat me? Why people try to misuse me? When we complain, that shows that we lack wisdom behind your heart. So when you do something, wisdom, you need a mindfulness and wisdom to control that, so that you won't be overwhelmed by somebody trying to misuse you or trying to do something better for others. So these are the six perfections that you can apply in your practice also.
Yes.
normally in our tradition is in one family, the parents always want their second children to be in a monastic life or the nunnery. So the parents would choose the second eldest. And then Rinpoche, when the local at the age of 15, because most of them, the four of them, the Rinpoche and the three, since they have to walk from Tibet to India, so they have to be old enough to walk. So most of them are 16 or 17 or 15 years old. But if they are too young, then they cannot walk. From Tibet to Nepal, so that time around roughly around 2 months, sometimes 3 months or so, because they don't know the global map, geographical map, so they walk all the way to the western Tibet, which is Mount Kailash, and then from there they walk back to Nepal. So if they know the map, then actually it's shorter, maybe it will take days to walk, but sometimes they walk all the way to the west and then walk down to Nepal. But because of the border, because border has a big river close by, so most of the monks often get stuck. If it is in the winter, they're stuck in the snow and they die on the snow. If it is in the rainy season, then the river becomes so big and then they are washed away by the river. And if it is in a proper season, then the security, the guard, the army in the water, they get killed. So they have to be, like most of them, they have to hide in the daytime and sneak at night.
By the time when they reach 16, they have already memorized thousands of pages. the subject. So we have debating and dramas, but what places we have to memorize, otherwise we won't pass in the class. Stay in the same class. That's why in monastery, first in after 16, then we will start the main course. So because after 16, those even young monks who are 16, then they have to put for thousands of monks. They have to be strong enough to lift the whole heavy load. So then they will join the main course. Otherwise, until they are 16, then they have to do all the grammar, study, memorization, is another small text. But when they reach 16, then they will start the main course. So in Monastery, as the Lord Tongue has explained, there are five major courses to study. Five texts, actually. First one is called the Logic and Reason. Logic and Reason about how the colors are formed, how many aggregates we have, and those things we study. And that study will be 5 years. 5 years of study. And then sixth profession is 5 years. And then entrance to the middle way, which means which is entrance. Everything is interdependent. Nothing exists by its own. So that study we study at least 3 years. So that would be that in that subject we study about like everything is interdependent, nothing exists of its own. In reality is all empty. So this one you can apply sometimes when you get overwhelmed by your own negativities and expectations. Try to analyze on that. That will really help you to control your own emotions. You won't get overwhelmed by your own desire or anything. Because in reality, it doesn't exist of its own. It is a parts and particles, compositional factors of many parts. Then we give a logo for mom, or me, or you. Otherwise, if you split everything apart, because you know that your skin and bone and blood and everything is split apart, lay on the table and then you point out who is this person, we cannot find. So just to form, we need all these parts and particles and then we keep a logo, that's me. Otherwise, it doesn't exist by its own. So that's all we have. Study on that. And then the fresh knowledge called the fourth part is fourth taxes. In that we study about how the world is created, how many forms are there, how many aggregates are there, and every molecule and atom and this Big Bang theory, cosmology, physiology, everything is included in that fresh knowledge. So we study that one for 2 years. And then finally we study monastic discipline, monks' ethic. Ethic we study 2 years, and in ethic, so monk has like 253 vow or precept, and all this ethic or the precept is just to control myself from harming others. It's all about how can I not harm others. It's how I just control every moment so that every action, in case it's harming others, they will try to stop you from those precept and vow. So we study that. So how many years we study? At least 18 years or 17 years we study that. And then repeatedly that we have to, if you have to go for PhD, doctor of philosophy, then the same five major texts we have to repeatedly, 7 times we have to do the exam. 7 times. And that 7 time repeated exam will be based on Indian commentary, Tibetan commentary. So this text is maybe it looks only a small volume, maybe around 200 pages or 300 pages. That pages is 5 years course, right? And
Because this small amount of pages of text has hundreds of commentary. Some commentary it says like it has like this volume, 5 volume. So that's why elaborate the commentary on that. And many master, Indian master, different Indian master has commentary on that text. Tibetan master has written commentary on that text. So sometimes we have to match together which one is better than the other one. So that's why they're debating on this view. So someone would like to read the Indian the text and try to debate, okay, this is the one that is written and explain what is in the text. So that's how the debate goes and then lots of argument will go in. Because sometimes some masters are highly intelligent. Some use their intelligence to compose and translate the true text of that content. And some of the masters will compose because